Today, we're here to talk about one of the top comments we received since we dropped our full movie breakdown, film criticism, and analysis of the 1995 movie Friday. And that is whether or not Ezal stole the boxes from Craig's job that ultimately got Craig fired.
Not only are we going to answer all of your burning questions, but we're going to talk about the controversies and rumors surrounding the events in the movie Friday that we discussed in many of the poll questions that we asked you throughout the week. Things like, do you think Craig really stole from his job? And was Big Worm wrong for holding Craig responsible for the money that Smokey owed him? And were Craig and Jody from Baby Boy really both just baby boys? Stay tuned. Directed by F.Gary Gray and written by Ice Cube and DJ Pooh, the cult classic film Friday tells the story of the newly fired Craig, played by Ice Cube, and his misadventures with his best friend Smokey, played by Chris Tucker, as they experience hood life to the fullest on a single Friday.
I'm Heit.
And I'm Cheri.
And you've discovered Axiom.
I can't wait to talk about whether it was really Ezal who stole those boxes that got Craig fired. But first, we want to thank all of the supporters who've helped to make this video possible. If you want your name to appear alongside these contributors, make a one-time donation via Cash App or click the thanks button on this video, or you can head on over to patreon.com/axiomamnesia or become a channel member by clicking the join button to enjoy all of the benefits of becoming a monthly subscriber. So in the comments of the full breakdown that we did on the movie Friday, a lot of you said that Ezal is the one who stole boxes from Craig's job and that's what got him fired. And you point to, in the director's cut, a scene of Ezal running down the street toward the beginning. There's nothing going on. It's just sort of the beginning montage of the film.
Right. And also, we did have a poll question that we asked in Friday. Craig was fired from his job after an accusation of stealing boxes and supposedly being caught on tape doing so. Do you think Craig really stole from his job? Tell us why or why not in the comments. A lot of people responded with that same comment that Ezal stole the boxes. If you watch the director's cut, you can see Ezal was running with the boxes. And some people say after, at the end of the movie, they show it. It's all different things that people say about it.
Yes. A lot of you, as you're watching, you're going from memory. You're going from like tidbits of things that other people have told you or that you've read, because we've all talked about this movie a bunch of times since it came out decades ago, right? But we actually went and watched the movie. We were watching the movie when we discussed it. And we went back and said, okay, could we have made a mistake? What is Ezal doing in the opening scene?
Yeah, so he's running and he's not holding the boxes that would be from a place, some shipping place.
Right.
He has a stereo and a speaker. And it looks like one of those record players that he has. And that's really what happened. And he didn't steal the boxes.
Yeah, he's not carrying boxes.
Yeah, so we could take a look at that. You see there's a cord hanging. You can clearly see that's like a record player that had the clear plastic over the top cover. And I think that sometimes, you know, somebody may say something and then you just run with it, right? And you just, that's could become your memory.
Mm-hmm.
And then it just doesn't go away. And if we come along and we say this, this is what's happening, because I think we showed it and we told everyone at the beginning of the video, we're watching the director's cut. You know, this is based on a director's cut that has extended scenes. Like at the beginning, we're introduced to some of these characters.
Right. And I also think that what happens is people have these misrememberings for reasons, like you said. I'm sure somebody in the comments, because we have one guy in the comments who always likes to bring up Mandela effects. Somebody's going to say it's a Mandela effect because they saw where it actually was boxes. But seriously, though, if you guys have an actual clip of Ezal stealing boxes, we couldn't find one. But if you find a clip and you're saying that this is why Craig was fired, then let us know, because we don't believe that Ezal had anything to do with Craig being fired.
Yeah, but some people said it was Debo as well.
Debo with the boxes?
No, they say because he was wearing the same thing that Debo. They had similar outfits, I guess.
But like, okay, let's just keep it real. Craig and Debo are way different sizes, even if they had the same outfit on. Plus, one had hair and the other one didn't.
Yeah.
I don't see how you mistake one from the other. I guess maybe in some grainy closed circuit television footage it could happen. But yeah, no. I just, you know. I mean, think about it. Craig has a beard.
Craig has a beard. Debo is bald. But they were saying because their clothes are similar. But one thing is he was fired the day before. And it probably wasn't based on what happened that day because he was off that day. So it could have been even a day before, 2 days before. They happened to be wearing the same thing on Friday.
Mm.
So it's not that, hey, they have similar clothes on Friday. So he got fired for some video from Monday because were they wearing the same thing Monday?
Right.
That's not in the movie.
Right. But we will. We will stand corrected if you could show us how Ezal or Debo is responsible for Craig being fired in the film, because, you know, we didn't listen to every single interview someplace where somebody speculated this or that. I'm talking about footage from the film. We would have no choice but to, you know, say that you guys are right. But I don't think the evidence is there.
Yeah.
So let's get to some discussions of some of these other questions that we had. Let's go back to the question that we talked about, that poll question where we asked, Craig was fired from his job. So now that we're saying that it wasn't Ezal, it wasn't Debo who got him fired, do you guys think that Craig really stole boxes from his job? Because when you listen to what Craig says in the movie, he's like, yeah, they say they got me on tape, that the blah, blah, blah. He never admits that he did it.
Supervisor called me about 4:00. Talking about they got me on videotape stealing boxes.
They say they got me on tape, and then Smokey's like, I know you ain't go out like that. He says no.
Hell no. They ain't got me on tape. You said they did.
But they say they got me. It's something about the way he says, but they said they ain't got me on tape. That's really what he's emphatic about. They don't have me on tape, but I don't know.
But they say they do. But I would be like, they don't have me on tape. You know, but he's just like, yeah, but they say they do, so oh well. Nah, bro, I ain't take no boxes.
Fire me on the spot.
Yeah, like there's just something funny about that exchange. But anyway, 84% of you said that Craig did not steal the boxes. Only 16% of you felt that Craig stole the boxes from his job.
But what about some people's rationale? So this guy, Arion, I guess is how you pronounce it, said he proved he wasn't a thief when he said, man, I ain't trying to get involved with y'all. When, you know, Debo and them were trying to go in the house, Stanley's house. There's this other time where after Smokey came out the window down at Felicia's house when Debo was over there, you know, Craig was like, come on, let's go back. Right. He's like, but you gonna go in, though.
Yeah. Yeah. But, now, to Craig's defense, it was after Craig already owed a bunch of money at this point.
Yeah. But still, just because he says that he won't get involved don't mean he doesn't do that, because he probably don't want to do a B&E, but he don't mind taking boxes from work. A lot of people take stuff from work, but they consider that different than, you know, just taking other things from other people.
Yeah. And so I don't know. I just think I think it's just like one of those things where, you know, he might not be a person who's going to sit up and mastermind some type of theft. But, you know, if it's low hanging fruit and, you know, whatever, and he thinks he could get away with it, he probably would steal something. And he was okay at varying times in the movie taking stuff.
Like what? What did he take? I guess he still.
Well, with the going back, like what you just said, he was okay with the theft when it was for his benefit, right? So go back in and steal from Debo, right?
Yeah, but it really wasn't Debo's stuff.
Yeah, I guess that's a good point.
But you still would have to break in somebody's house to do it.
This is true. Like, that's what I'm saying. So, you know, the lines are gray. Like, Craig is not like this wholesome and just completely moral character. I mean, we see that not just on the whole idea of theft, but we also see that with, you know, his dealings with women.
Yeah.
So then another commenter about the question of whether Craig really stole from his job said that there are several reasons why. One, Ezal is running with boxes in the beginning. Okay, we dispelled that one. Two, Craig seems like he's smarter than that. I feel like he was raised on the principle of you lie, you cheat, you steal, then you will kill mentality. He only smoked with Smokey because of peer pressure, and he had a gun to perform masculinity in a hood, but I don't see him stealing. Three, in my head canon, I think that the movie was making a commentary of jobs being racist and accusing any black guy of stealing because, quote, all black people look alike.
Wait,
I have to stop here. And I have to say, I agree that that is part of the commentary, right? That your job could be like, oh, I'm accusing you of stealing. Now, what we don't know is whether like his immediate supervisor, what was their rate? You know, we don't know anything about that. So it's hard to conclude that. But that could have been a quick commentary, right? Because how many times are just because the color of your skin, black people accused of theft and, you know, crimes and all sorts of things, right?
I'm not from LA and don't really know about like the specifics of, you know, the demographics there. But I would think like most of the people at those levels in a warehouse like that would probably be black or brown.
But maybe the supervisor isn't, right? And the supervisor maybe, but is the one.
I don't even know if it's white people in LA in 95. You know?
Of course there are. But, you know, the question is, were they in those roles or whatever? But, you know, that comment about, you know, basically, and the idea that all black people looking alike.
Yeah.
Okay, I could feel you. I'll give you, you get some points for that one because that is true. That's like a trope and whatever.
I think one thing is that it's comedy too. So some of that stuff is just in there for the comedy and it's not really making a commentary.
Yeah, but it's making a, I think it's making a commentary as far as comedy does it and in the way comedy does it, right? They take something, then they blow it up and make it way bigger than it really is, but it's still pointing back to some form of injustice or thing that's not right about society, maybe. The fourth reason that the person gives is he wasn't even down to rob dude next door. He was pressured to alert Smokey and Debo. His friend was involved, so he did it. We kind of just touched on that a little bit.
But I don't even think he did that.
Yeah, because in that scene, and if you watch the breakdown, like there's so much going on while he's supposed to be keeping watch. You got the neighbors fighting. You got the phone ringing. You know, he was very distracted. But the intent at the time when he agrees to do it is that basically he is participating. If you're the lookout, you're part of the crime.
Okay, you could say, hey, I'm the lookout, but you don't expect Stanley to be coming back so quick, right, where you would have to be involved. And your only involvement is whistling. Really?
Mm-hmm.
And I'll be like, yeah, sure. Come on. Just go in there and get me some money.
I know, right?
I ain't got to do nothing.
I know, right?
But then he just happened to have to because Stanley just popped up. Where did Stanley go?
I don't know, but he was only gone for a few minutes. Stanley was probably going to make a deposit to the bank.
He went to that same store.
On Friday, though. And then Stanley's like home on Friday. Why is he home? Is he just independently like wealthy at this point? You just off work, you're having a 3-day weekend. He's like home during the middle of the day, and somebody who seems like Stanley seems like he probably would have had a job that he would where he would be. But, you know, what do y'all think Stanley did for a living? Go to the comments and let us know what you think. So the next question and thing that happens is, of course, everybody knows in this movie, Big Worm holds Craig responsible for the money that Smokey owes him. So Smokey goes up. He tells Big Worm, hey, we were smoking your stuff. And then Big Worm is like, all right, well, if I don't get my money by the end of the day, I'm going to kill you both, right? Do we agree that he owed, Smokey owed Big Worm like $200 or whatever? Was it 200?
We don't know how much money it was.
Right. All we know is that Smokey counts out and Smokey has $100. Big Worm says, you only got $100. And it seems like what they need is $200.
Seems like,
right?
Because that's all they talk about. Oh, we got $200 from Stanley. Craig asked his sister for $200.
Right.
He said, we got into it with Big Worm. We owe him like $200.
But yet, Smokey had $100. You know what I mean? So there are some plot holes, some holes in the logic here, because a lot of you guys did point out like, oh, well, at the end of the day, didn't he only really need like $20 or $40?
And,
you know, you throw out 80, you know, some different numbers because they sold some of the stuff. You know, Smokey already had the $100, you know, and with that. So why was Craig going around and asking people for $200? Now, we'll get to that. But I was just trying to establish how much was owed. And we say that because was Big Worm wrong for holding Craig responsible for the money? Different people had different opinions about this.
Yeah.
Not surprisingly, though. So in the poll that we did, 81% of you said that he was wrong. Big Worm should not have been holding Craig responsible. And I agree with that because, like, why would Craig be responsible? Craig didn't have any quote unquote dealings with Big Worm directly about all of this. So how are you going to hold him responsible? That's crazy to me.
Yeah. But a lot of the people who said, who wrote comments talking about that he did, they mentioned like, oh, in the streets, there's nothing fair. But our question was it wrong? Like, just because people do things in a certain place, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or in certain situations, don't mean that I'm going to say it's not wrong that they do that.
Right.
And like, in the streets, nobody going to be fair. So Craig smoked, so he got to get dealt with. What?
And that's basically was the general logic of a lot of people, right?
But, you know, someone specifically said, according to the street code, they both had to get dealt with.
Somebody else said, yes, because in the hood, you're guilty by association.
Yeah, but that's wrong.
Yeah.
The question is whether or not it's wrong. But if people decide that their morals are based on whatever situation or whatever, then you don't really have morals. You just go along with whatever someone else decides.
Right. It's not consistent.
Yeah.
You know, your stance has to be whoever owes me directly and that I had to deal with is the one who's responsible, right?
Yeah.
Or that's the person who owes me.
That same person who said, according to the street code, they said, no, Smokey was wrong for putting him in it. So Worm wasn't wrong, but Smokey was wrong.
But
in the streets, can't you just put who you want in it because whatever, right? What's wrong is saying, oh, I gave this guy something and he gave it away for free. So the one who he gave it to for free got to get dealt with. But I just think it's interesting that they would say Smokey is wrong, but not Worm for deciding to, you know, do something to somebody who had nothing to do with the dealings between you two.
Smokey is wrong. Worm is wrong. Mm. Period. To me, I feel like Worm is wrong for saying that Craig is on the line. His life is in danger because of a deal he had with Smokey.
How wrong is Smokey, though?
Smokey is very wrong because he threw his friend under. You brought him into it. But
he didn't say I had Craig selling it for me. Right. But that would still be on you, Smokey. But he just like, you know how we did it. So he's saying I decided to smoke the stuff with whoever I did.
He was shucking and jiving, trying to get out of it, and then threw his friends under the bus. That's how I interpreted it. But
I interpret it that way, but that don't mean that he is wrong for mentioning how he squandered the stuff.
Well,
if I go to whatever, you know, I have a business and I get my inventory, right? And then I still owe my distributors or whoever, right? And I'm like, yeah, I undersold it. I gave it to Walmart for this price and Kmart for this price, and I gave some samples to so-and-so. They're not going to those companies.
Right.
And I'm not wrong for saying I did this.
Mm-hmm.
Even if Walmart or whoever the distributors go and sue those companies, I'm not in the wrong. Walmart is still, or whoever the distributors, in the wrong for trying to take it out on people who did not have dealings with them.
I agree.
And that's basically what Smokey done. He's like, yeah, I gave some stuff away for free.
Yeah, Worm is definitely wrong. Worm is the wrongest. Let me just put it that way. He is the most wrong. Smokey is also wrong, I feel like. And that's that. But, you know, that's just my interpretation.
Yeah.
Somebody else said, I say no, because in Worm's first scene, he specifically asked, was Smokey smoking his stuff? And then Smokey later admits to it after lying and then also throws Craig in it. So he's saying that Worm, this person is saying that Worm is not wrong because Worm asked, was Smokey smoking his stuff, and Smokey had lied. I don't think that has anything to do with Craig at all, except that Craig's name was thrown in it. But it's still like Worm should be logical deduction here. Like Worm should be holding the person responsible for it. But, you know, something funny that one of the commenters said was Worm should have got Craig first. They were kicking it too tough all day at the Jones household. None of this would have happened if Craig was job hunting, like he was supposed to be, like his daddy wanted him to do, right?
Yeah, I guess so, but come on now.
Somebody else said, the saying goes, if you with it, then you did it. That still don't make it right, though.
Yeah, but how are you supposed to know? Craig, okay, somebody's like, say, man, let's smoke this. That don't mean that Smokey didn't pay for it, right, or isn't going to cover that cost. How am I to know that this dude have no intention on covering the cost?
So another commenter said, I say no, meaning that Big Worm was not wrong, because he's just going off of what Smokey said. He wasn't actually there. And I doubt he knows Craig enough to know that he is a first time smoker or whatever. So he's just going off of what Smokey said. Smokey led with the Craig got fired and the whole story about like that, right? What was Big Worm supposed to think? Y'all think I'm just a joke is what he said. Just out here carelessly smoking on my stuff, especially since Smokey is supposed to be working for him. Big Worm is a businessman, so he just handling business. That was what the person's bottom line was. Big Worm is just, yeah, but shouldn't exactly. You handle business fairly, though?
You handle business with the person who you're doing business with, which would be Smokey. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing goes beyond that.
You know, so this person breaks it down based on the verbal contract, and they say,
oh,
Worm was wrong because the deal and contract verbal was with Smokey. Craig was not responsible for the deal, and he wasn't going to get any money from it. Also, if I'm a friend of someone and get to benefit from their position and power, I'm not entitled to anything from the people who's rewarding the person I'm friends with. For example, if I'm LeBron's best friend, I don't get free Lakers shirts from the Lakers. Likewise, when LeBron is finding a game, I'm not responsible for paying it.
Yeah. Or like, yeah. So if you had like Dennis Rodman back in the day, he's out partying.
Always getting in trouble.
Yeah. He's out partying. The person who he's partying with don't have to pay part of that fine because you know how we do it. We went to the strip club and got messed up. And then they're like, oh, you messing up my money too? Mm-hmm. Half of the fine goes to Dennis Rodman. Half of the fine goes to Jeremy Jenkins. Man, it's just...
doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it doesn't when you put it like that. One thing that people always talk about with this movie is that Craig was just paid the day before. He was like, I went into work, you know, and when I got home, they called me, told me, you know, they got me on tape still in boxes. So we asked the question on our community tab in Friday, why didn't Craig have any money left from his check to pay the debt to Big Worm if he just got paid? Like... And most of the people said his check wasn't even $200.
Yep.
That's about 51%. 32% said Craig bought the gun that he had. 9% said he had the $200 all along. And 8% said Craig paid the rent.
Yeah. You know, I kind of, you know, when you think about it, it is quite possible. Maybe Craig didn't even have a $200 check.
Okay. I can see that. But he had zero. Like, what did he spend the money on?
Well, so, some of y'all had some really good ideas about what he might have spent his money on, right? One person or multiple people said that, remember when his girlfriend Joy was on the phone and she said that she had seen him out at the movies with some chick? So the day before, maybe, now Craig denies he was out at the movies, maybe he blew all his money, right? That's a possibility. It didn't exist on a poll, but that's a possibility. Craig had the gun. We don't know how long he had the gun for. But I think that's a fair possibility because, you know, some of y'all even went deep. You went in and explained how much the gun would have cost back then and, you know, how expensive or whatever it might have been. So he could have blown his check on the gun at that point, too.
I just think, I don't know. The thing is that when you introduce this new gun into the film, like, where did this gun come from?
Mm-hmm.
And if this guy is just living at home with his parents, why would he spend his whole check or a good bit of it on a gun?
Right. Now, some of the folks were like, well, I thought he used it to buy the gun, but it's hard to believe his final check wouldn't have been at least $200. But if you just get paid, I mean, if he was going up to get his check, meaning that, you know, the check was at least a week, sometimes 2 weeks, right, behind in pay, then that wouldn't have been your final check. That would have been the check that you were owed at that time. So the final check, depending on when he got fired in the pay period, might not even be as much as the check he should have picked up that day, right? So, you know, that's one. And then some of y'all actually went in, and I thought this was kind of funny too, but talking about being basically a part-time employee at UPS. Now, we know that this is a fictional account. This is fictional. Craig doesn't actually, quote unquote, work for UPS, but we do see the brown uniforms, and it's all supposed to make us feel like a company like UPS is where Craig works, right?
Yeah.
Basically how they don't make that much.
Yeah. Minimum. Let's say he was getting minimum wage. Minimum wage at the time in California was $4.25.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know if L.A. had a different minimum wage, you know, kind of like some municipalities do. But yeah, that's California. And it wasn't raised again till 1996. And it was like it became 425 in 1988.
Well, and then somebody else brought up a point. Maybe he didn't have money because, and they claimed that the job withheld his check. Craig said that he went to pick up his check and they fired him on the spot. But why would they withhold your check?
Yeah, it makes...
Well, if you're accused of theft, I guess, but that's not something... They can't just withhold your check
exactly.
for something
like that. If you're accused of theft, let's say at the time he went, they was like, oh, you stole this stuff. They can't, but nothing prevents them from doing that, too, right? Because we know these employers do illegal things all mm-hmm. the time. It would be illegal, and I don't think they would. A big company, well, I'm assuming it would be a big company like that, would hold someone's check because they accused him of stealing. But what we know is he picked up his check and then he went home.
Mm-hmm.
And then he got a call talking about I was stealing box.
I mean, the whole thing is so like ridiculous and whatever. And then a lot of you would have said, and maybe to kind of loop back to the original question of did he actually steal the boxes? Because at the end, the supervisor has called and the father says, you know, your supervisor called.
Right.
So it seems like he's going to get his job back. That doesn't mean that he did or didn't steal the boxes. It just means that either they figured out or they thought somebody else did it. You know, like when it comes to these organizations, just because they do a thing doesn't mean it's proof of anything.
Right. And that was in the director's cut. So if you didn't know when that scene at the end is in the director's cut. But it doesn't mean that he's getting his job back or that they decided he didn't steal it. It could be, hey, come get your check on this day.
Yeah, your final check. I mean, yeah, we just don't really know what it means. And then somebody, like we talked about, you know, what did he do with his money? Did he buy the Glock with the money? You know, it just is, it's just up in the air. And I guess that really adds kind of to the humor of the movie. Like, why don't you have any money? Because when you start to pick apart and have these questions, it's like,
yeah,
this whole day wouldn't have happened. Another thing that comes up is why Craig had assets. If you need money, then why not use what you have? Wouldn't you barter? Like, okay, if I don't have cash, I have something that could be worth cash. And I mean, you already know Ezal. Ezal probably could have told you how to turn your
That's what
whatever
I'm saying.
It is
you
into
go to
cash.
Ezal, be like, man, I need to know how to get rid of this stuff, liquidate my assets. But somebody was like, never thought that he could have just given Big Worm the Glock. I don't know where that comes from, but I don't think the guy is going to be like, okay, give me your chain and a Glock. He want money.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
But Ezal could have helped him with that, right?
Yeah.
Ezal could have helped him turn the chain, the Glock, whatever assets he had into enough cash for this. But back to the question of cash, how much money do you think they really needed? And why did Craig ask everybody for $200 when he wanted to borrow it from his mama, when he wanted to borrow it from his sister, when he wanted to borrow it from Joy, his girlfriend? Why was the number $200? You know, was it because, I mean, surely Craig would have logicked that Smokey had some money.
Yeah.
You know, so why would he owe the quote unquote entire debt? Didn't make a lot of sense to me here.
Right. And since now... Oh, I'm adding something new.
Uh-oh.
Since now that they got the $200, right, he done roped Craig in. How much does Smokey owe Craig after this day? It's just wiped clean because they're friends, right? Because now he done transferred part of the debt to Craig. So, you know, he should share in the profits. Right? Or at least get paid back for his portion of that debt. He had to beat up Debo, right? So he owed...
To be clear, so what you're saying is that the $200 that Smokey gets at the end from Debo, which is kind of like free money, right?
Yeah.
That he then is going to turn around and apply to his debt. The debt that we all agree is solely Smokey's that Craig got roped into.
Yeah.
Shouldn't Smokey owe Craig some money?
Yeah. Here's an idea for somebody who wants to go viral. You watch this movie and you do all the money calculations in the movie and then figure out at the end how much Craig should be getting.
And you give us credit for the idea.
Because Craig is owed something. He has to be. Just like Smokey owed Worm, now Smokey owes Craig because Craig helped to pay the debt off. You know what I'm
saying?
Life
was in danger.
All of that, but just the financial... Like, he's owed something.
Okay, and then the other thing I just kind of just go back to is, like, y'all mean to tell me nobody would give you the money? Like, the $200, the Joneses had $200. They had it. Nobody would give Craig the money to save his life. But when something happened, and maybe they didn't know it was for his life, but still.
I have a question.
Okay.
So, if your friend asked you for, I don't know, $100, $200 because this cat y'all know from the block is going to kill him, would you give him the money?
I would ask for some details about what the situation is, and then I would probably give him the money.
Craig,
if I had it.
Craig told Red what happened. We know that Red just got paid yesterday. I don't know what responsibilities he have, but could he help?
Oh, well, Red could have helped, but Red, wouldn't helped, right? Because we know historically, you know, and that was part of the argument as to why, when Red was like, why y'all didn't help me when Debo came up, right? That was part of the argument. And then Craig starts to be like, well, what about that time in our backyard? You didn't help us, right? So they, you know, so Red wasn't going to help. I don't feel like Red would have helped for that reason, because he wasn't as good of friends with them. He, you know, he knew them would come around or whatever.
But I think they were good friends. But this is something different, right? This is life or death, just like we talked about with the sister and the parents. Dana knew he owed that, you know, what Warren was going to do to them.
But everybody was so concerned. When, you know, they knew, like, at the end, toward the end, when they're coming out to see what's going on, I heard gunshots and, you know, all of this. But, like, it could have all been prevented. We wouldn't have even needed the second part of that movie if his mama and one of them would have just gave him the money.
So that's what I'm saying. If they that concerned, and would you be that concerned for your friend when you know who Big Worm is and if something gonna happen to him? Would you really be willing to give up the money? That's a tough one to me, right?
Yeah.
Because you got your responsibilities. You just got paid yesterday. You're probably not making that much either. And your friend's life is possibly really in danger.
And more evidence that maybe he did buy the gun with it. Somebody brought up the point. I think Craig literally just bought the gun. And that's why when Smokey came through his window, Craig told him to be careful before he get blasted on. And then Smokey like, with what? You ain't got nothing, man. And then Craig pulls out the gun and puts it in Smokey's face. And he's like, with this. And all of that implies that Craig must have recently got the gun, considering even his best friend didn't know he had it, right? So
yeah, maybe, but do you, the only reason it came up because he just busted through the window like that. What if he had it for 3 weeks and it just, I guess you would tell, but.
Yeah. Well, the people who answered that he was paying rent were very much in the minority, because that he paid rent and that's why he didn't have the money, because one person was like, well, he paid his rent. Those parents weren't going to let him slide on his responsibilities, and they laughed. I'm like, man, I don't feel like it was the rent that is why he's totally broke.
And think about that would be terrible. Like, okay, you're living in your parents' house and you, I guess it's supposed to be like a stepping stone to get out on your own, and then they taking your entire check for the rent. Man, that's so a tough one, right?
Well, what would have happened? See, and this is what we know, and we're going to get to this in the end when we talk about the question of whether Craig was a quote baby boy, right? Because Craig was comfortable in general. He had his own room. He was paying some rent, right? And he was only paying rent because he refused to go to school. Because his daddy said, either you go to school or you pay rent, right? So, or you get a job. Presumably, if you're going to school and you don't have a job, his sister Dana wasn't paying rent. I think that's a fair assumption. So he was, but if Craig was uncomfortable enough because all he was completely broke just from the rent his parents were charging him, Craig would have got his own place, right? Because but Craig was comfortable.
Yeah.
The stuff he was complaining about was minor.
Well, he probably needed Smokey to make some money so that they could go half though too.
Yeah.
Or he got to move in with Joy, and you know.
And he don't really want to do that either. But yeah, so that's kind of the whole dialogue that happens with the idea of why Craig didn't have any money. And I mean, the jury is still out. Like, we really have no definitive answer to this question.
Yeah.
We're just speculating.
Yeah, so what would have been good if Ice Cube really, you know, paid for them rights. You insert movies in between that explains these things, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it'd be nice, because I think this is one of those franchises that would really do well, sort of like a Saw and stuff, where you could have 10 movies, you know, and kind of do it like Star Wars or whatever. Oh, we got this prequel and this prequel to this prequel and this, you know, all these different stories.
Yeah, it was a good idea.
Yeah.
You know, but we were talking about the gun And this is a good lead into one of the other questions that we ask, which is, why do you think Craig bought the gun in the first place? When it comes to that, 82% of you, the vast majority of you, felt that it was to feel safe. 13% of you said it was to show off. 3% said for other reasons that you explained in the comments. And then 1% said he liked guns. So I found this interesting because I think it was a combination maybe of to feel safe and to show off at the same time. That was kind of my personal answer to the question. But the number one answer, at least according to, or the number one comment, you know, with the ones that you guys had liked, was I think he bought it for a combination of reasons, mostly to feel safe. People don't really understand that the amount of trauma you experience in a quote hood situation is like a war or prison. He wanted to feel safe, but I also feel he wanted peace. He wanted to finally feel like he had some control over his life and that he could turn the tables in a tense situation if needed. He wanted to be left alone, but he also wanted respect. It's deep.
But I think there are millions of Black people who know what it's like to be in a hood area, because I think that's where most Black people live, in these urban areas all over the country, the North, South, and West, and East. I think it's very easy to be like, oh, you have to believe this because only a few are able to understand this. And I'm telling you this because I know it, when I think most people are in areas like this.
Well, some of the people who answered this question felt that it was for protection. And the reason that they give is because when Craig is having this conversation with his father, the father walks in on him pulling the gun from the drawer. And then the father asks, you know, why you got that? And he's like, you know, he needs to walk Smokey home. You know, the implication here is that it's for protection. But my question is, why would Craig, if he had another reason for it, be honest with his father in a moment where he's caught off guard? And and he, you want the most justifiable reason to give your parent in that moment. So just because that's what he said doesn't mean that that is the truth of the matter.
But no, it is the truth. He took the gun to walk Smokey home, right? In the moment, that's why he had it. He was going to walk Smokey home. But the question wasn't, why was he taking the gun out the drawer, right? The question was, why did he buy it? This is, I don't know, presumably days later, at least a day later. He didn't buy it to walk Smokey home. So it doesn't necessarily mean it's for protection. He could have bought it to show off, and now he has use for it. I don't know if it's to feel safe or any of that, because a lot of people pointed out, oh, he's not carrying it or anything, so it's not to show off. Well, then he's not doing it for protection either, right? Because you would be carrying it around this terrible neighborhood where anything could happen at any time, and he wasn't doing that until he got into it with somebody and he had to walk Smokey home. But I don't know. I think they needed a reason for him to have a gun, right? So they could have this shootout and for his daddy to have this conversation. And that's the only thing I see. And it presents situations in the plot, like, why would he spend his whole check on a gun?
Another person said that Craig knew that he was eventually going to have to deal with Debo, and he knew that Smokey was stayed getting into stuff. And so Craig, being a good dude for the most part, wanted to protect himself from whatever. This commenter was feeling like it's because of Debo, because, you know, Debo was the bully. He was shaking people down and stuff all the time, beating them up and whatnot.
But he didn't pull it out on any of those occasions with Debo.
Until the end.
Until the end, yeah. But after he had it because of the stuff with Worm. He just happened to have it on him. I know that thing was hot, but anyway. But he didn't use it on Debo. Why would you use it on Debo? I guess, you know, ain't no rules in the streets, but Debo wasn't doing nothing like that where you need to pull out a piece on him. He was just beating people up, man.
He was, quote, just beating people up.
Yeah.
People get tired of getting beat up. Not that I'm justifying it at all, but I'm just saying, you know, if you are not capable of beating him up back, or you feel like you might not be, then maybe you just take a shortcut.
Yeah, people do. But hey, what's right or wrong, right? What's justifiable, we talk about all the time, where a cop may be getting beat up and they pull out. Oh, what's the difference?
Somebody said that's why Craig got fired. He was stealing boxes and the gun was in one of the boxes he stole.
Nah, that's fun. So when they, that's another thing. When they say stealing boxes, was it just broken down boxes, right?
Well, but, yeah.
New boxes, boxes with stuff in it.
One of the write-ups or whatever, it was like, oh, he was for stealing cardboard boxes. And I was like, that is just such a weird thing. Why would he, was he moving? Why would he be stealing
that's
cardboard boxes?
That's what I always thought. He's just stealing the cardboard boxes.
Yeah. I mean, but I, you know, but then it's a shipping company. And it's like, okay, if you're a shipping company, wouldn't you be stealing the boxes? But I don't know.
No.
Maybe Craig did steal cardboard boxes because he had this grand plan that he was going to be moving because he was so dissatisfied with living at home and paying rent and there not being any milk in the house.
Where's the boxes? But if he was stealing packages, I think they would have said packages instead of boxes. So the packages would have had the piece in it. But
yeah,
that didn't happen.
So, A.
Anyway.
That, but, you know, that's that.
What's Craig a baby boy?
Yeah, that to me. Okay, so like that's going to take some real time to like break down. So what are we asking you when we say was Craig a baby boy? Well, if you're familiar with the movie Baby Boy, and by the way, we did an entire series, three video series on the movie Baby Boy, where we break down Jody and all of his stuff that he's got going on. The main thing is that people consider Jody a baby boy. Now, you got to look at the years these movies were made. And I think you summed that up really well when you talked about it when we were discussing this offline.
That Friday came out before Baby Boy, so we really didn't get this term Baby Boy until like 2001 when John
right.
Singleton put out that movie and basically attributed these things to him, which I guess we would have to agree on what makes Jody a baby boy. And by calling the baby boy, we kind of get clues from the beginning, right? Because he's talking about, hey, we call our home a crib. Yeah, so one of the things they talked about from the narrator standpoint, who is Jody.
What does a black man call his woman?
Hey, a black man calls his woman mama.
What does a black man call his closest acquaintances?
He calls his friends his boys.
What does a black man call his place of residence?
The crib, right? One thing that I would think it's, okay, you're still at home under your parents. You haven't moved out on your own. And mm-hmm. I think that's just the overarching theme of it. And you haven't reached the level of maturity to not be a boy anymore.
Yes.
As people would always say, to be a man. And then we know at the end of Friday, what does Pops say when she so-called put down the gun? Now you're a man, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's indicating something, but we didn't have that term in 95. And it wasn't looked at as black males being, you know, these like
infantile sort of
people.
Creatures.
It's,
yeah.
You just in your parents' home.
And, you know, I think another point that you had brought up when we talked about it was that, you know, was it fair? Was it fair that Craig was not considered a, quote, baby boy, even if we didn't have the exact term, like all that goes with who Craig was? But Jody was considered a baby boy. And so what's also important is the ages. Okay, we know Jody to be 20. Jody is 20 years old and baby boy. We know this because for a number of reasons, but especially because when they're in the garden talking, his mother says, basically, you owe me 20 years worth of money. So we know he's like 20 years old. Craig is 22. We know Craig is 22 because Craig's father said he'd been smelling his boo-boo for 22 years when he's in the bathroom, in the bathroom scene, right? So Craig is actually 2 years older than Jody, but
yeah,
their circumstances are different. And I think that that's why they judge him differently. But let's get to the poll first. 67% of you said that, no, Craig was not a baby boy. 33% of you said that you felt that Craig was a baby boy. Now, first of all, a lot of you were incensed that we would even ask the question. Y'all should know by now that we ask the questions. We ask the hard question. There is no sin in asking the question. And the question is not implying the answer to the question.
But
we're just simply saying, is this a possibility?
And these aren't real people, so.
They are fictional characters.
Like, come on now.
So here's what I think. I think that, look at their situations. Craig lives at home. Craig is essentially single. He has no children. He's 22. He has a job, presumably on and off. But if you look in this movie, we're judging this movie. But in future movies, we know that he jumps around job to job. We know that Craig expects for his basic needs to kind of be met. He's not a considerate person, but he expects his basic needs to be met by his parents. He has no conscience as to how much of the food that he's consuming in the home, when I'm sure he pays rent, but he probably isn't paying food bills. He's not buying his own food at that house. He's got the giant mixing bowl that he's about to pour half the box of cereal in. And he's disgusted, absolutely disgusted, that somebody didn't make sure he had milk to put on his cereal. He won't even cook his own breakfast.
Right.
He expected it from his mother, who was cooking her breakfast before she was leaving to go to work. Right. So he hasn't fully become a man. But then you have Jody. Jody, who has these complicated relationships with women and all of that, and has two kids by two different women.
Yeah. One thing about Craig, too, he wouldn't take the trash out. Like, we know his daddy was like, didn't I tell you last night to take the trash out?
Mm-hmm.
So it says this other level of responsibility that's not there. And some people pointed to, oh, he's not a baby boy because he don't have kids. And I don't know how kids make someone a baby boy at all. If it's only that, that's it.
I don't think it's only that. But what I will say is the way the kids figure into it is this. The fact that Craig didn't have kids gave Craig more time to be BSing in this gray area between childhood and adulthood. From the point you have kids, that's cut off because you need to be focusing on caring for your children. So whoops, sorry, your childhood has ended early if you had a kid young, but you got other things and more important things to do. Whereas Craig can dilly dally and take little penny ante jobs and not be focused. See, nothing his father wanted him to do. Hey, man, get a trade, become the dog catcher and stuff, right? Because he's trying to get him to the point where he could take care of himself. But trust and believe that the pressure would be a lot different if Craig had children.
Yeah.
His parents would be pressuring him way differently.
Yeah, but it doesn't make him not a baby boy. It makes you don't see how he's just basically doing nothing.
They're both baby boys. And let me also just say that they are definitely both baby boys. I mean, and Jody, and a lot of you brought up the fact that Jody, you know, was like trying to act like, you know, all this machismo, acting like he was the man and running stuff when Jody wasn't contributing and he didn't have a job and was a hustler kind of on the streets selling these stolen clothes, et cetera, right? And the nerve of him in that situation. But at the end of the day, they are both baby boys, but they look different because of something that we always talk about, and it is class.
Yeah.
It is social class that makes this look different. So Craig's parents have certain expectations with you know, them. They're like, okay, we're in our home. We own our home. We work. We're rearing you up to go to school or work. And if you're working, we want you to get a trade, right? There are things. And plus, Craig's parents, by comparison, are older than Jody's mother, who had Jody at a very young age, right?
But someone said, Craig lived at home with his family, both parents and a sibling. He either had to work or go to school. Jody was running in the streets between both his baby mamas and whoever in between. Craig had a more stable environment and still had respect for the house. I don't know about the respect for the house thing, all of that. So it's because he had both parents and a more stable environment that he's not a baby boy.
No, I think
that make him more of a baby boy.
That's the reason. That's a great observation. But that is the reason why his baby boyism looks different.
Yeah,
it's because his parents had different expectations. But at the end of the day, you know, they both had to harass. He was doing the same thing. They both had to harass their kids to get them to do the most basic of things. And Craig did have the advantage of his parents sort of having it together and being a little bit older than Jody's mother.
Exactly.
And he did have two parents.
But it's not about your parents. It's about what the child is doing.
Right.
So we know what Craig was doing. It doesn't matter if he has two parents. I think that would be the classism where you would say this guy, because he has two parents and a stable home, that he's not a baby boy, but someone else is.
Well, yeah, I agree that that is classism. And to be absolutely clear, when I pointed to social class as why it looks, I'm explaining that that's why it looks different. That's why Craig being a baby boy looks different than Jody being a baby boy. They are in different social classes, even both in California and presumably in similar regions, right? But it just looks different. They are not in the same social class. However, it's not a good or bad or right or wrong thing. It just looks different.
Right.
But at the end of the day, they're both baby boys, clear,
exactly.
Loud and clear.
But the rationale that people give is informed by class. They say, because this guy is of...
Well, that looks just like, is wrong.
Yeah. But they may be the same class, even though one has two parents and the other one doesn't.
Well, it's not because they don't have two parents that they're not from the same class. I think it's the values. I think it's the values that's espoused on the children. It's what's passed along to Jody. It's the mentality of Jody's mother. I need to be a thug to hold me down versus who Craig's parents are. It's just, it's different.
Yeah, but I think they could still be the same class because she was, if it's based on, you know, those mentalities, because we did have his mama saying basically the same thing that Pops was saying. And she was preaching, you need to take care of your kids. You don't need to be staying at home. If you're going to be here, you don't contribute and all of that stuff, right?
Yeah, stuff that she had learned by the ripe old age of 35, that when she was having the baby at 15, that she couldn't impart to her child.
I don't
know
if she didn't impart that before.
I mean, we could make assumptions. Yeah. I won't hear, but...
So, I just think that because he had two parents, that it's... The person clearly said it. opened it with, he had two parents. Therefore,
I think Craig could have had one parent, a different one parent, and still had a similar outcome.
Yeah, me too.
You know, but I'm open to the idea that they could be. I think that they're more likely to be by class, like not large class groups, but I'm saying within the class of people who make around this range of money and the socioeconomics kind of. What I would call subclasses, right? Yeah. Because somebody, you know, a sociologist might look at them and say they're from the same class. What I'm saying is that from our understanding and knowledge of Black folks and how we live and how we're different and what our cultures, our subcultures are, even amongst Black people, that I don't see them the same way. And I'm attributing that to class, not class as in being classy, but social class. So, you know, we could argue that in the comments, but
just like Craig was friends with Smokey, he could have just been basically friends with Jody. Just like, because when you look at it, Jody's friend was Sweet Pea, right? Mm-hmm. And Jody would go to him because he was the quote gangster, right? So it's, I guess as a comparison, he was worse than Jody was, right? Because Jody wasn't really street or none of that. Craig was basically not street or none of that. And Smokey was more. Even though Smokey wasn't nowhere near, right?
That's true.
And he just because he took up slanging some weed.
But see, Smokey and Jody were more alike to me. Yeah.
But at the same time, Craig got a gun. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. He done bought a gun. Like, is he farther along than Smokey? Which is a different conversation.
Yeah.
It's just stuff you think about.
I don't know.
When
it's like, yeah, you can get in the weeds with it. But yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. You know, I don't know. And as I'm thinking about it, you know, maybe my thoughts on the social class might be evolving, because that's a really good point about Smokey. Because Smokey is very much, in my opinion, like Jody.
Yeah.
Smokey, I could imagine, could have a couple baby mamas. But interestingly, he doesn't by that age.
And I think it's good that they didn't put that in these movies. That's just adding an extra element.
Mm-hmm.
But people did bring up that Smokey is the baby boy, as is it only has to be one. And they say Jody is worse when it's not a comparison. We're asking about this one thing, and I don't like that whole.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like it's a thing. Categorization.
Yeah.
It's like, do you qualify as the baby boy? Yes, all three of them do. Smokey, Jody, and Craig.
Yeah. But
period.
Some people say you brought in the other movies. Friday After Next came out in 2002, right? Hmm. We don't know how much later it is, but I'm going to just say that's 7 years later because you're looking 7 years older. So he's probably 29 by that time, and he finally got his place. It's one of the comments that somebody said. By part three, he had his own place.
Yeah.
Part three?
I mean, baby Craig should have been like a lot further along.
Yeah, but it's no indictment, you know? But that's part of the thing when you have baby boys conjures up all these ideas. So no, we can't contribute this to this character like.
Well, and remember, Jody was 2 years younger than Craig, though.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, Jody, a lot of people don't, and some people keep reminding us of this. We remind ourselves of this. But Jody and Yvette were really young. Like Yvette was younger than 20 and Jody was only 20, even though he did a lot of egregious things. But a couple other comments on this subject is like, remember how serious Craig was about having a rubber? No way that man would be in a position to be talked down to by a baby mama.
Wait,
so
I don't remember that.
I don't either. But I would just say that to me, some of this has to come from the fact that he had Pops, right? He had Mr. Jones there steering him about things. Mr. Jones was always there for a lecture. And I do think that some of the male-to-male transfer of knowledge and all that stuff.
Well, okay, he was like talked down by Joy.
Yeah.
He was talked down to by Joy. Yeah, she kept calling and hanging up and stuff, and you still dealing with her and stuff. Hey, what do you mean? Ain't no way. And it did. This didn't just start where she's like, who were you at the movies with? This was constantly happening over and over. So, no.
It was the whole time. That's, yeah.
So he.
But the part about having a baby, you see, there's a difference in how you'll let the woman treat and act and whatever to you, right? And having the baby. I do think that the reason that the responsibility level that Craig had about that was a direct result of, you know, Mr. Jones, his father, seeing his parents together and kind of having an idea of, quote unquote, what the acceptable way to do this would be.
But yeah, that happens all the time. You could have that guidance and you still end up having a baby. So
true.
It's just a lot is attributed to what your parents tell you versus what you do. But that don't necessarily mean that's how it's going to pan out.
That's true. Either. But then if they don't tell you nothing, then, you know, a lot of times it winds up being
exactly.
a typical situation. And then go ahead.
His who he chooses as a girl is going to indicate what type of person he is to me.
So I guess it's supposed to be like, oh, he upgraded when he got with Debbie.
Yeah. But look who he was with first.
Somebody said Craig actually had a job and was trying. He got wrongfully terminated. He was just trying to get back on his feet. Reminds me of like Savannah, you got a good man. He's just going through some troubled times that, you know, from waiting to exhale. Yeah. But anyway, Jody never tried initially, but when he did, he succeeded, which is a message in itself.
So let's say that's true. Jody was 2 years younger. Was it the 2 years that Craig was trying and he's still trying to eat big cereal out these big bowls and have his mama cook breakfast for him and all of that without any kids to have to take care of and give money to the baby mama to take care of his kid and all of this, right? 2 years. Was he not trying for those 2 years before he got fired, or was it just 1 year before, which would still make him a year older than Jody, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you still got to consider their ages. He had 2 years of not having a kid, and then Jody Ben had a kid right before that.
Well, somebody said that I think Craig had an actual plan. It might not have been extravagant, but he was on his way out the house regardless.
Bruh.
Jody was happy with his situation. It felt Jody like had he a was plan the man. Too. I don't think that Craig had a plan.
Even
I
mean, if you had a plan, that don't mean you getting out. That don't mean your plan is good. But yeah, what would be if Craig had a plan? What would it be?
Craig's only plan was just to pay the minimal rent that his parents were probably doing, enjoy life, be able to sit on the porch, go to work, have a minimal enjoyment with the little extra change he had in his pocket, and just chill and not have the pressure of paying rent on his own or anything else. He ain't bothered. Craig did not want to go to school or do anything that would be a long-term commitment for his future, like get a trade, right? Which is what his father would. So Craig was like, I'm living in the moment. I'm just chilling. I'm just, you know.
I'm not advancing.
Yeah, he ain't
I ain't
had
doing
no
nothing.
Plan.
Craig was a baby boy.
Somebody else says, to a degree, yes, Craig was a baby boy, but he was a man with masculine principles of respect and responsibility. He wrote it out with Smokey, even though he could have just left him on his own and sorted it out things out with Worm. Craig was trying to move on from the nest. Jody wasn't.
I didn't see anything in a movie that indicates that.
Masculine principles of respect. Well, I don't know.
I'm talking about the last part, but masculine principles, I don't know if you attribute respect to masculinity, but that's a whole different kind of conversation. But he was just at home with his parents. That's all he did. Where was he moving on to?
I just don't think Craig was trying to leave. And a kid like Craig is not really trying to do anything until he's so uncomfortable. Like, parents would have to make him so uncomfortable at home that he gets out.
If you're in a situation, you're like, I really want to get out this situation. I got this plan and everything. I'm working, saving up. He didn't even have the $200, right? So he's not saving up the money to do anything. But, okay, dang, I got fired yesterday. Today is Friday. It's still a business day. I'm going to try to get a job.
Yeah.
And he didn't do that. His daddy told him over and over, look at that paper over there. He did absolutely nothing but get into more trouble.
And think about it, right? If Craig had his own place and rent was due and it was an apartment, not just his parents who he could kind of finagle. Remember, Smokey said, is your daddy talking about kicking you out again? Right. So this wasn't even the first time. So if he was in a real apartment, just like we saw in Friday After Next, and they didn't have the rent and they needed their money and all of that, the pressure would be on. And we saw he responded to that pressure. But because he knew he lived with his parents, he wasn't sweating it. He didn't even go get a job.
He got his check yesterday. Today, he's absolutely broke. He's telling Smokey, you owe me $2. That's who Craig is.
Facts.
That's the day after your check. No matter what, something ain't adding up.
There's a lot of people irresponsibility who live like that. Payday is like Christmas. I go and I'm going to blow everything except what I absolutely got to have, except my car fare.
Some people, it's no question that you have to do this, right? Because you have responsibilities and stuff. He's still living with the parents and doing this. Baby boy, I can understand. Oh, I'm out on my own. I got paid yesterday, paid all the bills. I'm broke. All right. You're doing what you're supposed to do.
He won't even take out the garbage.
He's trying to throw away cereal, wasting the parents'
money.
Wasting
other people's
money. He didn't buy the cereal. You know what I'm saying?
And I think we could all relate to that a little bit, right? Yeah. Because, you know, when you're not paying the food bill, when you're not paying the bills, I think you're a lot more wasteful.
Yeah, exactly. And your parents could try to teach you and guide you all they want with all this costs money and all. But until you actually have to do it on your own, most people just don't really get it like that.
And a great example of this is cutting out lights at your house. Because, you know, when you're a kid, you'll leave them lights on, you'll leave stuff running, when you get to be grown, you cut them lights out when you see that electric bill. You start cutting. Oh, I see what my mama was talking about. Let me cut these lights off. I see what daddy was hollering about with the bills. Let me cut these lights off. Right. But, you know, you don't get it until you got the pressure on you.
Yeah.
And as long as he was living at home, he didn't have that pressure.
Yep. And then, you know, a lot of people brought up the other movies and, well, we pretty much got that same stuff. But it's the last one was years later.
Uh-huh.
Where he finally moved in. We don't really know what happened in between all that. So, you know, those other movies.
But this has been a great discussion. I loved covering this movie. If you watched this and felt like the quality of this video, of the previous video, our full breakdown that's like 2.5 hours long, if you want to see the full quality, unfortunately, you will have to become either a channel member or a patron in order to enjoy that, because we can't put that the full quality up here on YouTube. If you want to do that, the instructions on how to become a channel member or a member on Patreon are in the description, and then you'll be able to see this breakdown that we did as we intended for it to be viewed. And as always, we thank the people who are our patrons and channel members and people who give the special thanks and cash apps and stuff like that, because it really helps us out. It helps us to be able to deliver all of the content that we deliver. And by the way, we have an entire another channel, Heit and Cheri of Axiom Amnesia channel, where we do different sorts of movies. And if you're not subscribed over there, be sure to subscribe over there. That link is in the description as well. But we appreciate y'all so much.
If you want a space where you can constantly discuss these movies and everything, consider joining our Discord server, and y'all all can come together. We all could come together and discuss these things further. Well, you don't really have to wait for videos or be going to YouTube and looking under the comments, going back and forth. This is just a chat platform. Discord link should be in the description. But if you made it this far into this video, type "you owe me $2 in the comments so we know you're one of the real ones who stick around to the end.
Thank you so much, and be sure to check out one of the videos on the screen right now.